Well, you're back here watching that, and today we're talking about reforms in the public distribution system. But is there, in during that hearing, when the court took cognizance, the special bench took cognizance of this report, Justice Thakur is on record, and his comments have been published in various newspapers, that we are very reluctant in doing things which the government should do. This is what the bench told the Additional Solicitor General. Otherwise, we will say that Government of India's officers are too busy for other things, including sipping coffee and not bothered for PDS, thus we have to step in. The judiciary is saying that the executive is not fulfilling its duty and thus forcing the judiciary to step in. So many reforms we are seeing, and especially in the area of the food security, that the judiciary has been forced to step in. That means that the government has abdicated responsibility, not taking care of things that ideally it is meant to.
Well, in fact, of course, this is a general point, and I agree the influence that government is not doing anything it needs to do. But in PDS, we can be a little more specific. For instance, there was a time when, 2 months back, when Government of India had 80 million tons of stocks, where Government of India's own norms are that you should not hold more than 20 to 30 million tons of stocks. We recommended, as advisors to the Supreme Court, we recommended that at least in the 150 poorest districts, you make PDS available to everyone.
Yeah.
Why should you? You can debar 9 or 10% of people who are income taxpayers or holders of tractors, etc. But it was not accepted. Even Justice Vadhwa, I tried to plead with him that please recommend to government. The Supreme Court had asked Justice Vadhwa that you send recommendations. He did not agree. In fact, on the other hand, he said that there should be no allocation for APL. APL is a general category. APL doesn't mean people like you and me. APL means you are just above the poverty line. And if you look at them, next 30% who are poor, they are of course living below extreme poverty. Another 30 to 40% people are equally poor. To deprive them of subsidized grain, I think is a very big mistake. Unfortunately, in this report also, he mentions this. The other point I would say,
what he says is the APL beneficiaries don't pick up the stock, and therefore it is diverted.
No, this is not correct. It's only you and me who don't pick up our stock. We are not representative of the APL. We are in the top 2%, 3%. Just because 2 and 3% do not pick up, please find out. At least, first of all, in many poor states, there is no allocation to APL.
Okay.
Bihar, UP, Chhattisgarh, there is no allocation for APL. It is only the other states, southern states, northeast, Delhi, Jammu and Kashmir, these are the states which get APL. In this category, there may be some, maybe 5 or 10% people who are not taken that. So they can be eliminated. But to lump everyone, to all the 70% who are in the APL, and say they don't pick up, that's not true at all. It is totally wrong here. The other point I would like to say, and of course, I think you have been saying it, cash transfer has a problem because PDS is linked with minimum support price scheme, which is procurement. If you procure 50 million tons of food grains, then PDS is an outlet for 50 million tons of food grains. The two are interlinked. We cannot abolish PDS and at the same time keep on buying from the farmers. We can't throw it in the Bay of Bengal. Naturally, it has to be given to the people through the PDS. So therefore, we cannot think of cash transfer. What we can think of is a direct benefit transfer. That is, I have a card, the shopkeeper gets his allocation at 10 rupees, 15 rupees. I have a card, I take 2 rupees, I go there and pay 2 rupees to him. And by using this card, a subsidy of 10 rupees, 15 rupees is transferred to the account of the shopkeeper.
Okay.
That is a model which can work, but we cannot transfer cash to the person and leave it to him. That's not
one of the reasons why food, fuel and fertilizers have been kept out of
that without a cash transfer or without a direct subsidy transfer, you can still make the PDS work. But I think, you know, let 100 flowers bloom, let different states. What I'm completely opposed to is what Delhi is doing with Anushri, where you give 600 rupees, which is not inflation adjusted or inflation index, every month, and you say that, you know, this is enough for buying 35 kilos of food, and that's not possible. So that is a model that will die a natural death. So I'm not worried about that.
Okay.
And I think what Dr. Saxena said about subsidy transfer is something that could be considered. But even that is not required, because states have shown that even without that, they can work. On the earlier point, on this report, I have two disagreements. One is the APL, which Dr. Saxena very rightfully pointed out. The need for the RS to expand the PDS and not to contract it. And I wish I had also pleaded with Justice Wadhwa on a number of occasions that the committee must make recommendations on expanding the ambit and scope of the scheme, that it would have been a much better report if, for instance, Justice Wadhwa had said that we must eliminate and abolish the APL and BPL system completely and use the exclusion criteria to keep out some people and give green cigarettes. And you can have a robust exclusion criteria, because in India, our experience has been that we fail to identify the poor, but we have been more or less successful in excluding the rich in many programs and things, and it's becoming more and more easy to exclude the rich with banking, with financial transactions being monitored, with more tax returns and so on and so forth. So that could have been a dramatic and a very revolutionary change in the way we look at the entire program. The second disagreement I have with the report is this promotion of atta instead of wheat, fortified atta instead of wheat, because from a practical perspective, wherever it has been tried out, it doesn't seem to be doing very well. Because the quality of the final product, the consumer cannot know the quality of the atta by looking at it, but you can know the quality of wheat by looking at it. So there is a very big possibility that millers will take great quality wheat from government and replace it with rotten wheat and grind it, mix chalk powder and sell it to consumers.
Okay.
That's one. Second, the shelf life of wheat is more than 6 months, which is a more important point. The conditions under which this grain is transported, shelf life is much longer. Atta goes rancid within a month, unless it's vacuum sealed and packed in a certain way, like the atta that's available in made by multinationals, which is not possible for a large public distribution system. So I think that was a recommendation that was not very well thought out. But other than these two recommendations, I think the report is comprehensive. Justice Wadhwa has visited 19 states. A great deal of effort has been put in the last 5 years to do it. And the spirit of, we may disagree whether after it is deprivatized, should it go to the SHG or should it go to the food corporation. But the spirit that deprivatization is a must is something that I would stand by, which is the core and the essence of this report. Have a greater role for state corporations. Every state must have a corporation. Do end-to-end computerization. Deprivatize your ration shop. Rationalize your commissions. These are unexceptionable ideas. And I think this is Wadhwa has done a great public service by putting it out in the public domain and trying to persuade the Supreme Court. But I was in court when this happened. Tragically, what is happening is because Government of India is losing the initiative, the courts are stepping in. For the last 4 months, the courts are saying that, look, we know much of the reform and much of the plans that you want to do are in your food security bill. We also know that it is not under your control because it's a parliamentary process and we don't want to comment on it. But why don't you take the provisions of that bill and implement them through executive order? You don't need to wait for a legislation to reform the PDS. You don't need to wait for a legislation to bring about a change in the way you govern. So why don't you bring it to executive order? But the policy paralysis that I spoke about, because of so many
companies... That is not really an ideal solution, Viraj, because in the case of FDI and retail, we saw that even executive orders can be challenged by the parliament, and once they are done, they have to pass the scrutiny.
Controversial recommendations. Those are recommendations on which a societal consensus is not there, and therefore it was good that parliament debated it.
But that is what the political spectrum a claim right now that if the legislation is still under the consideration of the parliamentary committee, it has not been passed, that means there is no consensus right now.
Not at all. I will tell you what I'm the Chhattisgarh. Chhattisgarh has passed through their own bill, through that now. But they've been running this scheme for the last 6 years. So therefore, all the provisions of the food security bill, whether they apply to pregnant women, or they apply to free kitchens, or they apply to enlarging the scope of beneficiaries, all that can be done administratively.
Okay.
It doesn't require any law.
Just wanted to say, you see, I think the mindset is very clear. I think there is no government which would like to make itself paralyzed. I think we are just, somebody used this phrase, and I'm not a government spokesperson. No government would like to paralyze its own function.
Okay.
I mean, that has to be very clear.
Okay.
Second is, see, we have been about APL. We have been trying to define what is the target. What is the target? You know, more focus should be in terms of the way to target the target. You know, I mean, if you slice the population here or there, okay, there can be debates about, poverty lines, APL, BPL, and things like that. Let there be controversies and debates on that. It's important to target, but how do we target that? That should be the focus of discussion more than, just spending debates and debates on what exactly.
No, but creating this distinction between APL versus BPL,
that is important. That is important.
It leads to reducing the scope, the ambit of the BPL rather than widening it.
That is important. That is very important. But my point is that I have seen debates after debates in terms of our poverty lines, in terms of, defining it, as marginal, above poverty line and things like
therefore,
there is a very simple solution to the problem that is
suggested. And let me just complete. One more thing is that, all said and done, poverty has reduced in this country. I mean, you take any estimate, the affordability and the purchasing power of people might be varying from place to place, but that under different
regimes. But we don't really know whether it is.
No, but poverty has reduced and our concessions have been increasing.
Okay.
Now, this is the mindset that we are talking.
Okay.
Look, poverty has reduced, but it has not reduced at the, even though the government's own admission. When we are growing at 8% a year, poverty was reducing by 0.8% a year, by less than 1%. So that is not an issue whether poverty is reduced or
but our concerns are
that is true. But you see,
I don't know what kind of
society. I'll tell you why. Now but the issue is this. If you want the problem that he said about this, I agree entirely with him that we must not have this distinction. And what we must have is a focus on ensuring that whoever has to get a benefit actually gets it. And the solution to that is very simple. As I said earlier, we have done the socioeconomic caste census, and let's take that exercise to be very comprehensive. In that, they have used a set of very expanded exclusion criteria. And if you use those criteria, about 30% of the Ministry of Rural Development Loan pilot survey showed about a 27% exclusion. About 30% of the population will get excluded. You have the remaining 70%. Why don't you extend not just the PDL but other benefits to the 70%?
Okay.
That would solve a lot of our problems of inclusion and exclusion.
Okay, well, poverty is yet another debate, obviously, because as I said earlier, it's still an unsettled issue. The definition of poverty, we are yet to arrive at a consensus on that. But I'm afraid that's all I have time for in this edition. We can take that debate some other day. Dr. Saxena, Viraj, Dr. Das, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
That's all we have time for in this edition of Insight. Thank you so much for watching us, and do stay tuned to the Subhash Radio. I'm sorry.